Hello, welcome to Basics of Finite Element Analysis. In the last class, we had developed element level equations for an Euler-Bernoulli beam, and also we had developed logic and expressions to enforce continuity of displacements across common nodes, and also force balance relations, which are relevant for common nodes. So, what we will do today is continue that discussion further. And for a beam which is broken into two small elements, we will write first two sets of element level equations and then assemble them using the logic which we had discussed in the last class. For element 1, so this is our beam and this is element 1 and this is the second element. And the equations for element 1, the equations are K11 and so you'll have to be a little patient, but I think it's important that I write these equations explicitly, otherwise the understanding may not be clear. So all these relate to element 1, so I have a superscript 1 here. And these are my generalized displacements, which is the u vector, and then I have force vector corresponding to the first element plus point forces and moments . So these are the equations for the first element. At the risk of sounding very repetitive, but it is important, I will do the equations for second element. And all these are related to the second element, so there is a superscript 2 everywhere. So this notation helps us avoid confusion and keep track of things, and these types of notations we frequently use when we actually write computer codes, where we assign number for each element. So this is for element 1 and this is for element 2. Okay. Now, our continuity condition was that U13 is equal to U12 and that equals U So this is the continuity condition I am going to use. So it is equal to U3, and the other continuity condition is U41 equals U22 is equal to U4. Okay. So I replace this by U3, and in the second equations for the second element, I again replace U21 by U3. So that takes care of the first condition. Then the second condition is U41 equals U22 equals U4. So I replace this by U4, and in the second set of equations, I replace U22 as U4. And then I know that this is my global degree of freedom, which is U1. So I change it to U1, and the global degree of freedom as which right now is U12 is U2, and the same thing goes for U23. This is U5, and this is U6. So this is the first set of changes I do before I actually merge these two equations. Okay. So now you have 8 equations, 4 for first element and 4 for second element, and I have 6 degrees of freedom. So I have a total of 2 extra equations which I have to eliminate. So for that we use the force balance relation. Okay. So we see that F13 plus F21 equals F3. So the equation where this F13 appears, so is, I will call this equation 1, or I will actually number these equations. So this is 1, 2, and I am going to number them 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 and 8. So right now I have 8 equations. And if I see, if I look at these two conditions, then the right side of, if I add the right side of equation 3 with right side of equation 5, I will write right side of equation 3 with right side of equation 5, then that will be the total force. So I have to add these equations. So we add up equation 3 and 5, okay. And I, while adding up, please remember that I know everything in this F column, because my function F is known and I have to just multiply it by shape function and integrate it over the element. So this F vector is known, so everything here is known, right. So we add up equations 3 and 5 and enforce the first force balance relation. And similarly, we add up equations 2 and 6 to take care of this second set of force balance relations. What does it say? F1 of 4, which is this term, plus F2 of 2, which is this term, right. When I add these up, that will be the total force, which I will call F4. So this should be 4. So this term has to be added with this term, and similarly, this term has to be added with, no, not that one, I am sorry, this term. So then I get, so then in that way I get a total of 6 equations. So that is what I will do in the next step. So I get a bigger matrix K11, K121, K131, K141, 0, 0. So, I will have a 6 by 6 now, because I have eliminated two equations. And actually, I will make a little more space here. And my global degrees of freedom are U1, U2, U3, U4, U5, U6. And this equals F1, F2, F3, F4, F5, F6. Plus Q1, Q2, Q3, Q4, Q5, Q6. Okay. This term is actually equal to F31 plus F12, and this guy is F41 plus F22. So, what you see here is that there are certain stiffness terms associated with the common node, where the stiffness gets added. Also, the other thing you will note is that this assembled stiffness matrix is also symmetric, because when you look at this term and these two terms, K43 and K134, they are same, and K21 and K12 are also same. So, when I add them as the overall, excuse me, stiffness matrix is also symmetric. So, for a bilinear symmetric system, whether it is second order or fourth order system, the stiffness matrix will also come out, will always come out as symmetric. Okay. On the right side, I have the force vector due to distributed force and also a force vector due to concentrated loads, generalized loads. So, this one Q3 is equal to Q31 plus Q12, and Q4 is equal to Q41 plus Q22. Okay. So, at this stage we are ready to apply the boundary conditions, but before we apply the boundary conditions we make couple of other observations. So, if Suppose this is my beam, and this is node 1, this is global node 2, this is global node 3, right. And I have some distributed force here, then the F vector takes care of the force loading, you know, the forcing situation due to this distributed load. Now, if in our beam I do not have at these intermediate nodes any point external, any point force or a point moment, right. See, there could be a beam, there could be two cases, case 1 or case A, and this is case B. In case A, at node 2, suppose I am having some point load, and also suppose I am having some moment M. Then I will replace this entire thing by the first one is point load, let us say this is P, then I will replace it by minus P because it is pointing downwards, and this Q4 I will replace it by minus M because again it is, no, this is clockwise, so I will replace it by M, plus M, yeah. So this is case A. In case B, at this common node there is no external force. What that means is that this, when I add these up, this was Q3, they will themselves cancel again each other and the total will be 0. So in that case this term will become 0 and so will Q4, okay. So unless I have at the intermediate nodes, common nodes, some external point forces, these point generalized forces which could be either shear force or a moment, the Q terms at common nodes will add up and they will become 0. So that is why these things go away. There's a 0 here and a 0 is here also. So again, I mean, we don't just make it 0 in all the cases. If we have point loads, then we have to enforce those conditions, okay. So assume that our case is same as that of B, then I have, I know all F1, F2, F3, F4, F5, F6, you know, because I know this, the nature of external load. The things which I do not know are U1 through U6, so 6 unknowns, and then I also do not know Q1, Q2, Q5 and Q6, these are the, so total I have 10 unknowns and 6 equations. So again, I need 4 extra conditions, and these 4 extra conditions will come through our boundary conditions. These 4 extra conditions will be related to the boundary conditions. So this beam has 2 boundaries, x is equal to 0 and x is equal to L, and at each end I will have 2 boundary conditions. Either they will be related to the primary variables which are W and its slope, or they will be related to associated secondary degrees of you know, secondary variables which are shear force and bending moments. But at each end I have to specify these 2 conditions, then I will be able to predict how this system is going to behave. So that is what we will do in our next class, and thanks for today, and we will again meet tomorrow. Thank you.